here we started on our long-awaited journey. As you can see here, actually said it was 1 day and 11 hours with no stops. Whilst you head out and through the city, there's tons of speeding signs, so always be sure to check what speed you're going. You wouldn't want to get caught out this early on the trip. After a couple of hours on the road, we came up to our first town where we of course had to stop and get some subway. Although there are a lot of country towns ranging from 1 hour to 3 hours in between each, it's always a good idea to be prepared with jerrys full of fuel and water. Always better to be safe than sorry. You can pick them up for under 20 bucks from either Bunnings or any camping store. We filled up about 2 of each and didn't use them right until we got to the Northern Territory. And of course, you won't find much service out there, so it's always good to bring some other form of entertainment like a book. I know that downloading movies is always a good idea, but sometimes staring at a screen can be a little tiring. You will see your fair share of roadkill. This is just a reminder not to drive in the dark. Kangaroos and other wild animals are attracted to the headlights at night, which can be particularly dangerous if you don't have a bull bar. About 15 kilometers before our first overnight stop in Charville, we found this little rock pool here, which we were dying to go for a swim in. It was so refreshing after being in the car all day, so definitely worth a visit. The first day was probably one of the longest drives we had to do, which was around 9 hours, but we finally made it eventually. We were just cruising along when all of a sudden there was a confetti bomb of feathers all over the car, so we had to inspect under the bonnet to make sure the bird hadn't gone in the engine, but we were all good. Since we were traveling out of season, we didn't have to book any of the accommodation too far in advance. In Charville, we stayed at the Cosmos Country Motor Inn. As you can see, it's very spacious, so it's a perfect motel for families. It definitely has a very cozy feel to it after a long day of driving. Not only that, but there's a large open plan kitchen for you to cook any breakfast, lunch or dinners. As it was our first night on the road, we decided just to head out for dinner and explore the local town. We ended up going to the RSL, which is basically like a pub for military and veterans. We got up bright and early so we could make some breakfast and hit the road. There is a local IGA to get anything you may need. The next stop on our itinerary was a place called Longreach in Queensland. We could definitely tell we were starting to get closer to the NT when we saw the red dirt. Even the roads were tinted red, which I thought was so cool. There's definitely some strange old signs out in the middle of nowhere. But something I thought was a particularly helpful concept was the fatigue zone trivia questions. They have them up around every 5 kilometers, starting with the question, hint, then answer. Okay, this might sound stupid to anyone that lives in the middle of the outback, but I thought tumbleweeds were a myth, something you just see in cartoons, but we saw so many tumbleweeds across the road and we saw this sandstorm as well. Our bed for the night was at a place called Wellshot Hotel. It's about 20 kilometers outside of Longreach at a place called Ilfracombe. In my opinion, it's the perfect outback retreat with great value for money. Like I said, it was out of season, so there wasn't too many tours going on around the times that we were there. But we found this public swimming pool and spa bath right down the road from where our hotel was for only $1 each. They also have the Qantas Hangar Museum in Longreach, which looks pretty spectacular. However, the opening hours are a little bit awkward this time of year. For dinner, we headed to the highly recommended restaurant on TripAdvisor called Harry's. They have a range of cocktails, steaks, and other things from the grill. Pretty expensive, but of course, what do we expect in the middle of nowhere? Can you believe the population of this place is just under 3,000 people? Once we got back to the hotel, we had a couple of drinks at the Wellshot pub. The staff were lovely, and this little pub dog was even lovelier. His name was Cracker. He followed us all the way back to our hotel room, where we gave him lots of cuddles. Again, we woke up nice and early. It's always important to get on the road before the sun hits its full potential to avoid the engine from overheating. Since this place didn't really have a kitchen, we just had some cereal and I went for a shower, but I was literally in love with the vibe of this motel. It's definitely a backpacker's dream. If you have kids with you, or even if you're a kid at heart, this is definitely something worth checking out.
It's located in Ilfracombe, where there's a whole mile of old tractors and farm machinery which you can read about.
Enjoy these views of a whole lot of nothing, but I think that's the beauty in it, having no service and playing a good old game of I Spy. Our last overnight stop in Queensland was a place called Mount Isa. Rather than a country town, this is actually a city, so it's pretty well known. I highly advise getting yourself a fly face net. I have one from when I visited Uluru, so at this point I was really regretting not bringing it because they are unbelievably annoying. The scenery was always changing every couple of hours we drove, but we could definitely tell we were coming into Mount Isa. Tonight we were staying at the Sunset Top Tourist Park. The thing about road trips is you've been driving all day, you do not need luxury but just somewhere to rest your head. That's why budget hotels are a great place just to enjoy the simpler things in life, like jumping in the pool after a long hot day just like we did. We got given a recommendation for a small local pizza shop called Frank's Pizza. It's an authentic Italian owned shop, so it was definitely delicious. We took the food and ate it at this little spot, which was Lake Mundara. At the lake, there's tons of picturesque spots and off-road driving tracks. Something I noticed was that Mount Isa was a very industrial looking town. Despite this, there's a pretty decent lookout point at the top of the city. It's a perfect spot to look out on all the city lights. Head to Lookout Road and keep driving to the top where you'll find free parking. Come the next morning, I'm trying to finish what's left of the milk since it can be pretty hard to keep food cold on the road. Depending what we had on us, we would stop at the local gas station to get some fresh ice for the esky. But most of the time, motels will provide the basic necessities such as tea, coffee, soap, and sometimes milk. There were a couple of suspected floods during our trip, so this is where things got complicated. When doing our research before, we'd seen that there was two different routes to our next destination, Tennant Creek. However, according to maps, there was only one 10-hour route. Due to weather conditions, it had blocked out, but after doing our own research, we decided to go that way anyway, since it was substantially quicker. We got pulled over a couple of times throughout the trip. One was because an oversized load was being transported through. Going back to what I said earlier, Jerry's are essential. Look at the price of that fuel. It's literally the only fuel station between Mount Isa and Tennant Creek, so they know they can catch you out. Also, yuck, the toilets weren't the nicest, but I guess they're eco-friendly. They weren't equipped with much, so another essential would be baby wipes and hand sanitizer. As we were coming up to the Northern Territory border, we saw a sign that said road closed. We were so worried we were gonna have to turn back around, but luckily it was just a misunderstanding. There was a small setup with police just checking border entry forms and explaining the entry process. It just goes to show how unclear information can be online with all the weather conditions and COVID situation. Now that we were back in our home state, we headed straight to Tennant Creek Hospital to collect our PCR tests. According to the guidelines, you must do one on day 1, day 3 and day 6. You must take a photo of it next to your ID and keep it just in case someone from NT Health contacts you. Now, I love the NT and all the culture it holds, so I was pretty excited to stay at Tennant Creek. Our accommodation was the Outback Caravan Park. I really liked how open and airy this accommodation was. And on top of that, it amazes me how you can sleep a whole family of four for literally next to nothing. How adorable are these recycled trees that they paint with different designs? We wanted to go to the Devil's Marbles so bad, otherwise known as Kalu Kalu. However, it was getting a bit dark and we wanted to see it at sunset, so we thought we'd head to it another day. Instead, there was a local option called the Pebbles. It's a rock formation just like Uluru, which apparently radiates the sunset into a red/orange colour. Unfortunately, the day we went, it was a little bit cloudy, so we didn't really see too much. However, it still was so beautiful. It was a little bit awkward to find on the maps, and there wasn't too much information about it online. So if you did want to visit, your best bet is to head to the Telegraph station and then take the next left. Obviously, you aren't allowed to walk on it due to the preservation rules. It seems to be a lot stricter with the COVID rules in the Northern Territory, therefore all of the restaurants were closed by the time we wanted to eat, so I just ended up grabbing food from the local BP garage. In the morning, it was AJ's birthday, so we wanted to do as many things as possible, so we woke up extra early to go and check out Lake Mary Ann. Us being from Darwin, we were a little bit sceptical about jumping in the water in the Northern Territory. It was our last full day on the road, and it only took a couple of hours to get to Daly Waters. Daly Waters is a tiny little town about 6 hours south of Darwin. It is home to one of Australia's top voted pubs. And I definitely understand why. There is so many little quirks here, including these two little cuties, which we made friends with.
How are you doing? How are you doing? Huh? Is there some machine issues?
I see that looking.
Just opposite, there's this old museum which only requires a $2 donation. There are tons of vintage bikes, cars, and my favourite part is it's filled with memories of previous travellers. Of course, we marked our territory too. We took a Polaroid photo and stuck it on the wall. We met a couple whose birthday it was as well, which was so lovely, so we celebrated together with an ice cream. We went back to say bye to our friends again, and of course, he wanted to wish AJ a happy birthday. We actually found some spare thongs in our bag that we didn't need anymore, so we wrote our names and stuck them on the thong tree. So if you happen to see one that says Euphoric Escapes, give me a message. I can imagine this place to be heaving during event season. There's also a mechanical bull, which I wouldn't say no to. So here we are on our last day of travels. We passed through a couple of exclusion zones. What that means is there's less than 80% of the population there that are vaccinated. Therefore, if you've just entered the NT, you are not allowed to stop there. I honestly love being on the road, so I was really dreading getting back to reality, but here we are pulling up into Darwin. As you can see, we were welcomed with some lovely storm clouds. Obviously, every journey and every route is different. However, it just shows how important it is to do your research beforehand. So I hope this video helped anyone wanting to take this route in the future. I would definitely recommend it as a safe and fulfilling one, whether you just need to get somewhere or want to explore the outback. Let me know if you have any questions and hit that subscribe button below. Euphoric Escapes, over and out.